All right, it's Sunday, April the 19th, and we're continuing Bible questions with Pastor Ken Hovind. We have 28 days and 22 hours until until the trial on May the 18th, and I'm hoping you get released way before then, but we'll count down the days just in case. So Pastor Ken Hovind, let me bring up our first Bible question. I think it comes from Julie, and Julie, she more has a request. I think Julie's concerned we may be entering the tribulation, and so Julie writes, please ask Brother Kent to consider doing Bible studies for us on great men of the Bible whom we can learn from to prepare for the tribulation to come. So she seems very concerned about preparing for the tribulation, and maybe some comments about how to do that and what to study in the Bible to prepare for that.
Okay, thank you for the question, Julie. Yes, in my book I wrote, What on Earth is About to Happen, for Heaven's Sake, the entire last section, appendix number 7, is all about that. Okay, tribulation is coming. What do we do? So I would suggest you get that book and look there. Jesus said, in the world ye shall have tribulation. It's going to happen. John chapter 16, verse 3, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. Be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. I was guilty for 40 years of not distinguishing the difference between tribulation, which is what the world does to us, and wrath, which is what God does to the world. There are scores of examples in the Bible of people who went through tribulation. What do you do? Sometimes God gives a warning. Moses and Noah is going to rain. Build a boat. Okay? God gave a warning to Joseph and to Pharaoh. Hey, you're going to be starving for 7 years. You might want to get some groceries saved up. So that's the story of Joseph in Genesis 39-40 in that area. So the long answer to your question, Julie, would be in my book, which has 7 appendixes. Appendix 1 is about what's the creation about. Appendix 2 is about the flood, what happened. Appendix 3 is about Daniel's visions. Appendix 4 is about the time of tribulation, that 7-year period. Appendix 5 is about the time of wrath and the finishing part of that, called the day of the Lord. Appendix 6, the great white throne judgment. And Appendix 7, okay, what do we do? In light of all this, what should we do? So I think you'll find a very long answer to your question right there with loads of practical advice. Just ask God to guide you for that. All right, hope that helps. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question comes in from Ryan. And Ryan writes, good day. I think that may be an Australian thing. Good day, Pastor Hovind. I will keep my introduction brief. I'm from, Cairns, Australia. I've been a Christian a few years now, and I have watched so many of your debates and DVDs, which have been so encouraging. I have a question I'd like to ask. First question is, Australia has a diverse range of marsupials, hundreds of varieties. What's your opinion on how they got to Australia after the flood? Do you think that due to the number of varieties, this could have been
60 seconds remaining.
This could have been an example of microevolution? Second, I'll leave it off there, and he's asking if that could be an example of microevolution.
Okay, let me call back and discuss that.
All right, thank you, Pastor Hovind.
For customer assistance, billing inquiries, or to block future calls, dial 1-877-650-4249. To hear the cost of this call, press 8 now. To accept this call, press 5. This call is subject to monitoring and recording. Do not use three-way or call waiting features during this call. Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
All right, thank you, brother. Was that the end of the question? How do the marsupials get to Australia, and why so many different kinds of them?
I think so, and then he goes on to write, do you think due to the number of varieties, this could have been an example of microevolution? He has a second part to the question, but they're unrelated, so I'll stop here.
Okay, yes, thank you for the question. I cover the answer to that on my video series. It's been 8.5 years since I've seen it myself, but video number 6, which covers about the flood. If you look at the planet Earth, you'll notice there are continents and oceans, but the oceans have two very different parts. There's the shallow part around all the continents called the continental shelf, and then there's the deep part of the ocean called the abyss. I believe shortly after Noah's flood, the oceans were smaller because a whole lot of water was trapped in the form of ice at the North and South Pole. If he froze a couple zillion gallons of water and stuck it at the North and South Pole and made ice caps come all the way down to Kansas City, like obviously they did, we see the glacier effects, you can see them all over Minnesota and central Canada, the thousands and thousands of kettle lakes they're called. But you'll notice if you lowered the oceans just 200 feet, let's just pick a number and say two to 300 feet, then the oceans average 12,000 feet deep. So 200 feet's not much compared to the 12,000. If you lowered the oceans 200 or 300 feet, froze all that water, stuck it at the North and South Pole in the form of giant ice caps, all of the continents would be connected. You could walk anywhere. I think right after Noah's flood, everything was connected and they could walk from Noah's Ark to Australia. Because the water between Australia and, say, Vietnam and that area is full of islands, Indonesia, etc. It's not very deep, 30 feet or so. Generally, real shallow, all through there. You can find a map that shows the depth of the oceans. You'll say, wow, this is all pretty shallow. Between England and France, it's only about 100 and some feet deep, the English Channel. England would be gigantic if you lowered the oceans just 300 feet. You could walk over to Iceland and Greenland and North America. It's all connected. So I think right after the flood, everything was connected for a couple hundred years. It would take for this ice to slowly melt back, raising the oceans, which is why we have a continental shelf. And probably in the days of Peleg, Genesis 10:25, the earth was divided either by the rising oceans or by political divisions or by languages, maybe all three. But that happened in the days of Peleg. That's another story. Now, I think it's pretty obvious that marsupials, kangaroos, etc., are less aggressive and wouldn't handle a fight very well against, say, a tiger or a lion or a bear. So coming off Noah's Ark, the animals would migrate away from each other until they found a suitable place to have a house and raise their kids. But generation after generation, they would have to continue migrating further away from any ferocious animals that they couldn't handle in a fight, just for safety of their families. So there would be a migration wave that would take maybe a few hundred years and maybe a few dozen generations, and they would slowly migrate away from the more aggressive animals. I think two things were happening here. The animals are migrating away from the ark over a period of a few hundred years, taking over the entire world, and the oceans are slowly rising, and eventually the kangaroos got as far away as they could get in Australia, the marsupials did, and ended up being rescued by the rising waters, and they're separated from the ferocious animals, the tigers and stuff of Indonesia. So probably they got trapped on Australia. Now, the only marsupial I'm aware of in America is the possum. Marsupial simply means an animal with a pouch. And there are the kangaroos, or the primary ones, and I don't know how many flavors there are, 20 or 30. There's one that climbs trees. There's the wallaby. There's the great kangaroo, the red kangaroo. And you got a bunch of flavors of kangaroos over there. I think it would be pretty obvious that they could have easily had a common ancestor, and it was a kangaroo. The different varieties of kangaroo is evidence of microevolution, no question in my mind. There are several varieties of possums. And there's a lot of varieties of dogs. See, microevolution is really a bad word, a bad term. It should just be called variation within the kind. It's the same kind of animal. The different kangaroos are the same kind of animal. So it could be there were two or three different varieties that made it from, Manoah might have had a couple of different kinds of kangaroos on the ark. I don't know. Maybe all kangaroos can't be traced to one ancestor. Maybe they can all be traced to two. Okay, well then Noah had two pair on the ark. I don't know. But anyway, I think they got trapped in Australia by the rising waters, were able to prosper there, take over the whole continent. And they diversified based upon natural selection. Natural selection certainly works. It selects. It doesn't create anything. It only selects. So in areas where it's real dry, not much rain, certain types of kangaroos would survive that other types would not. But some animals need more water than others. The variations would become more pronounced because of natural selection and natural pressures based upon a variety of things. You know, the water available, the food available, like Darwin's finches. Some are on an island that had hard nuts to crack, and only those with the tough beak can survive. The ones with the skinny beak can't crack the nuts, and so they starve to death. And so pretty soon all the birds have a big beak. Okay, I agree that happens. That's natural selection. It's not creating a thing. None of the birds ended up with a sledgehammer to break the nuts. They all ended up with just a tough beak. Nothing was created. It was only selected. And so, sure, the varieties of kangaroos probably could be traced to a common ancestor, and it was a kangaroo. That's not evolution. As far as, like, the platypus and the wallabies and, you know, marsupials, it would have had to have been a Noah's Ark. I don't know anything similar to a platypus. What a screwball-looking animal. The first one they sent back, I understand, to a taxidermist, to a biologist. They tried to tear the bill off and said, this can't be true. Somebody must have sewed this on here. It must be a taxidermist. They are a strange, but they are an amazing animal. Little electrodes in their bill that they can sense when shrimp are moving under the water with an electrical impulse. How on earth could that evolve? I mean, it is just a phenomenally designed animal. It does look a little screwy, but it is really amazing testimony of the wisdom of God. That animal is designed perfectly to live and to do what it does. Every animal is perfectly designed to do what it's supposed to do. God is awesome.
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
Rather than glorify the invisible evolution God, people ought to glorify the God of the universe that created these animals. Anyway, thank you for the question. I hope to get down under and visit you one of these days. Thank you.
Amen, amen, amen. All right, Pastor Hovind, the next question comes in from Laurel. And Laurel sends you a message and a question. She says, hi, Kent. I have a question concerning a young lady at my church. She is presently working at a restaurant that serves liquor and is wondering if, being a Christian, it is wrong to serve others alcohol. Kent, I pray that you and Paul Hansen will soon be out of jail. I remind myself, as I'm sure you must often do, that God will work all things for our good, even if we don't understand or see his working in our various predicaments. I think you've brought much joy to that jail and glorified God all the while. God bless your faithfulness and patience in Christ, Laurel.
Well, thank you, Laurel. That is a tough question. You work at a restaurant, they serve alcohol. I would not do that. I would get a different job. The Bible says, woe to him that giveth his neighbor to drink. I have never tasted alcohol, Lord willing, never will, except for NyQuil a couple times. To me, I draw the line right there. I won't do that. I don't think it's necessarily the unpardonable sin or it's, you know, wicked, awful, and God's going to judge you, but I couldn't do it. So my recommendation would be find a different job. I think you'll find there's a lot of jobs out there. It's a big world. There are two kinds of income. There's active income and passive income. Active income is where you go to work and you get paid. If you don't go to work, you don't get paid. That's your daily job. But passive income is where you work really hard one time and get paid the rest of your life. For example, you work really hard fixing up an old house and turn it into a rental house, and now you have rental income. You get paid for years for 6 months' work. Or you work really hard and you write a book, and now you get passive income. Or you come up with an invention. You work really hard, invent something new, put a patent on it, and now you have income for years. So that's I would look toward getting some passive income. While you have the active income, I would also look for 5 or 6 different jobs. Make money off each thing you do. In the evening, instead of watching TV, hit socks or do something that you can... all the old-timers did this. They tried to make every minute count just to survive. But God will bless you, I think, with a different job if you'll ask him and say, look, I can't do this. I can't serve alcohol. Or maybe ask the restaurant owner, can I work in a different part of the restaurant instead of being a waitress? Can I be the cook? Or can I sweep the floors? Or I don't know. But again, I don't think it's the unpardonable sin. But you ask the question, and my answer is I wouldn't do it unless I was really, really desperate. Okay, thank you for the question.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question comes in from Rob, and Rob writes, 2 Peter 3:16 says about Paul, also in all of his, excuse me there, 2 Peter 3:16 says about Paul, also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. What is this saying and referencing?
Well, I think Peter is saying what everybody has noticed all through history. Paul's writings, some of Paul's writings are hard to understand. The guy was a genius, and he writes in language like, okay, you get all done reading, and what did he say? Some of Paul's writings, which is 14 books out of the New Testament, have some difficult passages, and people still argue over them. What does this mean? That's perfectly fine. I think the Bible's written so the average person can learn most all of it. It's wonderful. You can dig on it for years. But the smartest person in the world can never get it all. There's always some more to learn. It's like, wow, what a book written on multiple levels. So, and some people twist Paul's writings to say things that it doesn't say. For instance, in Hebrews, about they take it to say you can lose your salvation. You know, if you could sin again after if you would turn away from the Lord after you've accepted, it's not possible to renew them to repentance. Well, people twist that to say, see, you can lose your salvation.
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
Paul is saying, if it was possible to lose your salvation, you couldn't get it back. He didn't say it was possible. He said, if it was possible, you couldn't be saved again. So people twist Paul's writings and get all kinds of crazy doctrines out of there. So I think that's what Peter is pointing out from 2 Peter 3, that Paul's writings are a little hard to understand in some spots, and some people twist them to their own destruction. Anyway, thank you for the question.
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question is about Christian television, and I'm not sure how much you've had a chance to watch in the past 8 years, but I'll ask the question anyway. I think it comes from Arthur. Arthur writes, my wife and I watch the major Christian television networks often, such as TBN, Daystar, and God TV, which all air uplifting programming mixed with excellent Bible teachings. With so much questionable content all over television networks, like these provide good options for Christian families like ours. I hear both pros and cons about Christian television and know that, just like anything, there is always the good and the bad. What are your thoughts on these networks and Christian television in general? I also notice that some of the finest creation-related programming comes on after midnight on these networks. Chuck Missler, Answers in Genesis, Way of the Master, etc.
Okay, the reason a lot of these programs are after midnight is very simply is because it's a whole lot cheaper, because not many people are watching. Of course, you can, you know, TiVo it or whatever they do these days and save it and watch it later. But yeah, it's a lot cheaper. A lot of ministries, they want to reach the world, but they've got a limited budget, of course, and so they say, okay, let's get our message out, but let's do it after midnight and let people record it and watch it later. So in general, as you asked, I love Christian television. I think it's wonderful. We should use all these modern conveniences to get the gospel out. Some people say, old fashioned, oh no, we shouldn't use these newfangled ideas. Well, do you use electricity? Do you use a telephone? Do you use a car? You know, of course, you can. There's nothing wrong with the technology and using it to spread the gospel. I think we certainly should, and I do, produce videos, DVDs. When I was a brand new evangelist, I spoke at Smyrna Baptist Church in Pensacola.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Brother Julian said, Kent, this material you have is incredible. You've got to get this out. You've got to produce DVDs and sell them. Or said, back then it was videotapes. I said, oh, no, brother, I'm not going to do that. He said, listen, you can't go everywhere. You won't live long enough. Your videos can. They can cover the globe, produce videos. And I took his advice and did, and wow, they have certainly covered the globe and made enemies every place. I got folks I never even met that hate me, Rudy. And I'm a nice guy.
I know it.
Okay. Anyway, yeah, let me call back. Are there more questions?
There are some more, sir.
Okay. Right, I'll call
you. Okay, very good. All right, Bible questions with Pastor Ken Hovind. RUDDAVIS at yahoo.com. We do have some more, but
Sheriff's Office. This call will be recorded and monitored. Your advance pay account balance is $34.33. For customer assistance, billing inquiries, or to block future calls, dial 1-877-650-4249. To hear the cost of this call, press 8 now. To accept this call, press 5 now. To decline this call, hang up. This call is subject to monitoring and recording. Do not use three-way or call waiting features during this call. Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
Okay, thank you, brother. One more thought on the Christian TV. There are some really, really good programs on there, and there are some really bad programs, some really dumb ones, and you have to learn early in life to eat the meat and spit out the bones, or you will choke on something. So I do not recommend everything I see on Christian TV. There are some that make me embarrassed to be a Christian because of the stupid things they teach. I heard one guy say, if you'll send me $20, I'll pray God will heal you from your poverty. I thought, you have got to be kidding. This is going to heal his poverty, not my poverty. I mean, that is just so stupid. Or lay your hand on the TV and you will get the feeling. Look, you want to get the feeling, you go stick your hand in that TV. Then you'll get the feeling. It's just plain stupid, in my opinion. So I know I do not recommend all Christian TV. There is a lot of good stuff there. But just be cautious. It's like shopping. It's like anything else. Just learn to eat the meat, spit out the bones. Anyway, thank you for the question.
Okay? All right. No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. This next question comes in from Rick. And the font is a little bit small, and I'm trying my best to read it. Rick writes, may God bless all of us, all of his laborers in Christ, and keep us safe. Dear Pastor Hovind, we pray for your soon release to the glory of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. In Romans 9:13, the Lord declares, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. And in Genesis 33:10, it is recorded, Jacob, upon seeing his brother Esau, stated, I have seen thy face as though I had seen the face of God, and thou wast pleased with me. He says, text in 33:10 KJV. And Jacob said, nay, I pray thee, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then receive my present at my hand, for therefore I have seen thy face as though I had seen the face of God, and thou wast pleased with me. Question. I heard a preacher teach that Genesis 33:10 was proof that Esau was saved. What is your view concerning Genesis 33:10 as compared to Romans 9:13? We thank our Lord for your ministry. May God continue to bless you and yours. Rick.
All right. Very interesting. That's a fascinating passage, Jacob and Esau, twin brothers. I think Jacob talking to his brother, I saw you like the face of God, I think he's simply lying, buttering him up, knowing this brother wants to kill me for what I did to him 20 years ago. So I think Jacob is just simply, it's a snow job, okay, pure and simple. Oh, you look so beautiful, you're so wonderful, you're the face of God. I think he's lying to his team, open opinion. As far as why God loved Jacob and hated Esau, it wasn't because either one of them were righteous necessarily. But Esau loved the things of the flesh. He sold his birthright for a bowl of porridge. The guy's an idiot. He was more concerned about the flesh than he was about the spirit. I'm in a room with guys that have wasted their entire inheritance, wasted every bit of money they've ever earned, satisfying the lusts of the flesh with drugs or alcohol or women or something like that. They just don't get it. Their flesh dominates everything. I've asked many of them, I said, if you had all the money back right now that you've ever spent on alcohol, cigarettes, or drugs, how much would you have? And they'd think, like, man, I could buy 20 houses. Okay. Well, then why did you do that? Why would you start a habit that is going to satisfy the flesh for a couple hours and cost you so much money? Why do you want to put a butt in your mouth? Poke those things, you know. Don't do that. So, but Esau had that same attitude that many people today have. Their only concern is to gratify the flesh. Jacob, as wicked and sinful and dumb as he was on some things, he wanted to please God, and he wanted to satisfy the spirit. It's just a whole different philosophy of life. So I think that's why God hated Esau and loved Jacob. It was because of what was important to him. The flesh was all that was important to Esau, and God hated that. Now, we do have a body. I have one. We all have one. And we do have needs of this body, like we have to eat and drink and sleep, etc. And we get tired and thirsty and hungry. Okay, I understand. I got one. Had it for years. But man, if that's all you live for is the flesh, you are asking for disaster. Don't do that. Jesus fasted and keep me. Paul in Romans 8, he said, I keep my body under control. Control the desires of this flesh. Don't let them control you. You control them. But so that's my answer to the question. I think it's the conflict between those two brothers is the classic conflict between the flesh and the spirit that all of us have to face. Which one are you going to satisfy? What are you going to live for? If you live for the flesh, you'll reap destruction. You live for the spirit, God will bless you. All right. Thank you, sir, for the question.
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question comes in from Teresa. And Teresa writes, "Hello, Pastor Hovind. A couple of weeks ago, you mentioned you had only had pizza once in the last year. Many of us quickly got on the computer and ordered a pizza for you. Did you get them? Last week, I ordered one for Paul Hansen. Did he get his yesterday also? I'm sure you will have enough till trial by everyone's generosity. But I don't want Paul to be forgotten. Blessings, Teresa."
It was wonderful. We got, when they called my name and said, "Hovind, you have 9 fresh favorite meals." I said, "Oh no, what am I going to do with 9 of them?" It worked out perfectly where there were 9, counting me, 9 people in our Bible study who've been memorizing verses and trying to learn the books of the Bible in order. We all crowded in my room like a Bible study, and everybody had pizza and chicken and whatever it was. It was wonderful. Thank you, Teresa. I appreciate that very much. It would be better if you just simply put that money on those guys' accounts and let them order their own. I mean, I had to give one guy a T-shirt here, one of our new converts. He was just freezing to death. He doesn't have anything, so I'm going to buy him. Tonight we order commissary. I'm going to buy him a thermal top, even though it's Florida and it's,
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
They keep it freezing in here just to keep the germs down, so I'm going to buy the guy a thermal top for $10 or whatever. So, by the way, he needs, if you want to put money on his account, Paul Bloom, B-L-O-O-M, the third. I don't know how you do it. Rudy, I think Ernie knows how to put money on the account. I don't know how to do it, but anyway, that would be, just put $10 on his account and let him get what he wants. That would be, just send him a little note. I led him to the Lord last night. He's come to our Bible study for religiously, I mean, every time for a week, the whole week he's been here. So last night I finally said, "Paul, do you know if you're going to heaven?" He said, "No, I sure don't. I've been teaching him mathematics and helping him get ready to take his GED and stuff like that." And he was just right for the pick, and it was great. He's 31 years old, was married for a short time, has a little 9-year-old girl. They all moved off to someplace, and he just really is broken. And then God is really working in his life, so if you want to help him, do that.
Praise God.
Put money in his account. But anyway, Teresa, thank you for the fresh favorites. It was wonderful. I loved it. And with 9 of them, if I got 20 of them, what would I do? There's 36 guys in here, and I can decide, okay, who gets it, who doesn't. I didn't have any enemies, but it would be worse. If you would put the money on the account, the guys can order their own, and then there won't be any conflict that way. But
oh my goodness.
Use a gift. I just don't want to get in trouble and get beat up because I don't have enough. Thanks. Anyway, thank you, and enjoy. I love pizza, and especially pepperoni pizza, and it was great. So thank you so much. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. That's quite a situation. All right, Pastor Hovind, the next question comes in, I think from an anonymous pre-trib friend, and he writes, "I'm asking these questions with the utmost respect. I have a great deal of respect and admiration for Kent.
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
And the amazing work he has done for Jesus. And the questions Kent got today, he gave defense for his post-trib rapture, quoting from the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, 29 through 31. My first question for Kent is, are you willing to change your stance on the post-trib rapture if pre-trib can be proven biblically and theologically sound?"
Okay, absolutely. I don't care what anybody else says. I'm not beholden to any man or any denomination. I read the Bible. I believe what it says. I did believe the pre-trib rapture for 40 years, and that was being a pretty diligent Bible student. I just didn't catch it. I switched about 5 years ago, said, "Wow, I have been deceived and mistaken and lied to. It's not true. I am now pre-wrath, but if you can prove to me from the Bible, and don't get a King James, and don't confuse tribulation and wrath, they are not the same. Wrath is what God does to the world. We are out of here before the wrath of God falls. 1 Thessalonians 110 and 59 and many other places. But I would love to see somebody show me from the Bible the pre-trib rapture is true. I would love to get out of here today, but it's not going to happen. We are going to be here for the tribulation. So answer to the first question is I would quickly change back if I felt that was true. Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay. All right. This is a fairly long email. Some of these things are almost better for written letters, but I'll work through it. We'll work through it together for the time that we have. The next question he has is, next, do you believe in replacement theology?
I do not. As I understand those words, the replacement theology people are teaching that the church has replaced Israel. Israel's no longer part of God's plan. He's done with them. He's sick. He's dead. He's done. And it's now the church. I have some good friends who believe in replacement theology, and they try to talk me into that, and I disagree 100%. We are the wild olive branch, Romans 11. We are grafted in. We are trying to produce a little bit of fruit. We're not doing too good. God is not done with Israel. He has not cast them off forever. They are coming back. They are still God's people. So God's promises will be fulfilled. I do not believe in replacement theology as I understand those words. Okay,
no, thank you. Moving along the letter, have you ever heard of a time in your life where you couldn't have been happier to be wrong? I know I have. If so, get ready to be overjoyed because Jesus could take us at any second. No offense intended, smiley face. I would agree with you that Matthew 24 would be insinuating a post-trib rapture if it were not for two little words. And then he puts in quotes, the elect. Have you, Kent, ever heard of the teaching that the elect, the vast majority of the time, is referring to the Jews, specifically Israel, and those of the Jewish ethnicity, not the church? Also, that it is not even necessarily referring to the Jews who are saved. Did you know you can cross-reference Matthew 24:31 with Isaiah 11:12 for proof that it is speaking of the Jews? And maybe that's a good time to pause there.
Yes, I strongly disagree. No question. The Jews were God's elect, and so are the Christians, God's elect. I think you can chase it down and find we are elected for different things. The Jews are elected to be God's people. Once you're saved, you're elected to go to heaven, so I disagree that that always means the Jews. As far as the Lord could come at any second, I would show you just one simple verse. Go to Revelation chapter 10. In verse 11, the last verse in that chapter, God is telling John, the Apostle John, who's on the Isle of Patmos, and nobody argues with this interesting factoid, the book of Revelation is the last book written in the New Testament. John was the last surviving disciple of Jesus. He's in prison, or deserted on an island. Maybe it was a prison colony then, but he's on the Isle of Patmos. He's been thrown off there to be imprisoned. According to tradition, it's after he'd been boiled in oil and then sent on to the Isle of Patmos. And in Revelation chapter 10, verse number 11, God tells John, or the angel says to John, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. Okay, he's saying, John, you're going to get off this island and go preach to these people. It specifically gave him seven churches he's going to go preach to. And John did. When he got off the island, he went back and preached to the seven churches.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Which are listed in Revelation 2 and 3. Well, hold it. If God is telling John, you're going to get off of this island and go preach, and this is the last book written, then the pre-trib rapture cannot be true. The idea that the rapture is imminent can happen any second. There is no place in the Bible where it teaches that. Because this last book says something hasn't happened yet. The rapture could not take place until John got off the island and went and preached to those churches. That verse alone completely destroys the idea of the imminency. Jesus can come at any second. No, he can't. Something has to happen first. I'll call back and we'll finish that.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. All right. Yeah, I've heard the Doctrine of Eminence talked about quite a bit, so looking forward to this. Send me your Bible questions, RUDDAVIS.
$26.14. For customer assistance, billing inquiries, or to block future calls, dial 1-877-650-4249. To hear the cost of this call, press 8 now. To accept this call, press 5 now. To decline calls, this call is subject to monitoring and recording. Do not use three-way or call waiting features during this call. Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
Hey, brother, is this a good time?
Yes, sir, it's a good time.
We are having fabulous Bible studies. Everybody's loving it. A lot of new converts. It's just, you ever see a mama bird go back to the nest and baby's got their mouth open?
Praise God.
Feed me. It's awesome. Anyway, yes, ready for more questions.
All right. Someone suggested I play this Richard Dawkins video. He makes the statement that creationists know nothing. So maybe it would be good to play this and have you comment on what he has to say. It's on Communist News Network, CNN. So.
How long is it?
It's about 3 minutes long.
It's always nice to know how much torture you're up for.
Yeah, this is absolute torture, but if you're
very, very good.
Here we go.
I think we should look at the history of religion and be fascinated by it, just as we look at the history of art and so on. But I don't think that religion has anything useful to teach us. One of the main reasons why people are religious is because they're persuaded by the apparent design of living things. And that's completely destroyed by Darwin. If you actually read any book by a biologist about evolution, it's hard to see how you could fail to be persuaded of it. The evidence is just absolutely apparent. There's no doubt about it. It's not a controversial issue. It's completely certain. It's as certain as the fact that the Earth and the other planets orbit the sun. More than 40% of the American population, if opinion polls are to be believed, think that the world is less than 10,000 years old. And that's a shocking figure. It shows deep, profound ignorance. It sounds very laudable to teach the controversy, to teach both theories, but there aren't two theories. There's only one theory around. There's only one game in town as far as serious science is concerned. Of course, there's negative reactions from creationists, but who cares about creationists? They don't know anything.
All right, that's about all I can take, but... Who cares about creationists? They don't know anything. My goodness, there's only one game in town, and that's evolution.
Well, this is Dawkins' standard line, has been for years, and before him it was somebody else, and before him it was somebody else, and before him it was Satan. This is simple. To make that stupid claim, there's only one game in town, there's only one theory, well, he's simply wrong, okay? He can believe whatever he wants. It's a religion. He's very dogmatic about his religion, there's no question. And he's a great spokesman for his religion, but that doesn't make it true. He says it's not controversial, there's no doubt about it. Well, he's lying. His religion of evolution is extremely controversial, and there's no evidence for it whatsoever above what we mistakenly call microevolution, or actually variations within the kind. And why are people religious? He said they're persuaded by the design they see. Well, duh. If you walk into the woods and you find a painting hanging on a tree, you would be persuaded that there was a painter, whether you ever get to see the guy or not. And whether you, even if you can never find him. People, they commit murder mysteries. They look at the clues and they say, wow, somebody murdered this guy. Let's go find it. They chase the evidence down. They follow the lines of evidence. It's common sense 101. Of course you're persuaded by the evidence. The evidence says, hey, there must be a designer. Richard, what is wrong with the designer concept? Do you so badly want there to not be a designer so that you can justify some lifestyle or something? I don't know, but Romans chapter 1 talks about you, where it says they do not want to retain God in their knowledge, so God gives them up. God may have given up on you. I don't know. I hope not. But I may never get you converted, though I'd be willing to try. But I'm more concerned about the people that you are destroying. You're destroying the faith of young believers. You're taking young minds full of mush and training them to believe the stupid theory of evolution, that we all came from a rock 4.6 billion years ago. There is no possible way to prove scientifically the Earth is more than 10,000 years old. There are lots of ways to prove scientifically it is less than 10,000 years old. And you say that believing that shows deep, profound ignorance. I'm sorry, I would have to turn that around and say, Mr. Dawkins, it is deep, profound ignorance on your part to say that we all came from a rock 4.65 billion years ago, or whatever the magic number is this year. I'm sure it will go up, not down, over the next few decades. So I think it is deep, profound ignorance to believe that dogs and bananas are related, which is certainly what you do believe, and that humans and cockroaches are related. That is deep, profound ignorance. But that's okay. Ignorance can be fixed. Stupid is forever, but ignorance can be fixed. So I'll be glad to try to help, and I'll be glad to come debate you at my expense at your university anytime you work up the nerve. So you're right that it's not all people believe in creation, and not all people believe in the, evolution. I'm working on that. I'm trying to get them all to believe the Bible and believe in creation. And so I'm working on spreading my science, and you work on spreading your religion. And we'll see Judgment Day who was right. Anyway, that's sad. Sad that he's spreading that dribble all over the world and all over the Internet. But that's okay. He has a right to do that. He has a right. He has a perfect right to be wrong. Has a perfect right to teach that stupidity. That's perfectly fine. And I have a right to teach what the Bible says. We have a right to do that. No problem. Let's keep it up and see whose ideas win in the common market. Thank you.
Amen. New round of Bible questions, April the 19th with Pastor Hovind. Pastor Hovind, the next question comes in from Anonymous. Oh, I'm sorry. It might be Connor. It's nothing at the top, but at the bottom it says Connor. So Connor writes, Genesis 44:5 says, Is not this it in which my Lord drinketh, and whereby indeed he divineth? Ye have done evil in so doing. And Connor would...
Oh, it's from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
Connor would like your commentary on that particular verse on what that might mean.
Well, Joseph, in that verse, is obviously trying to impress his brothers that he is able to tell the future or tell something. I think this is all a big show for the, because his brothers think he's an Egyptian. And of course, the Egyptians were very superstitious and had all kinds of gods and all kinds of idols and statues all over the place. They built the big pyramids to bury themselves in so they would get to go to the afterlife. So they certainly was a highly religious culture. This was part of the plan to get him to test his brothers. Joseph could not use that cup and tell the future or divine. This is part of the show to really check what's in his brother's hearts. That's all it is. It's he wants them to think that he's able to divine, i.e. tell the future or learn truths that are otherwise hidden. I think it's just part of the dog and pony show. Worked great, too. The brothers revealed their heart to him, and he could see they had truly, honestly repented. Keep in mind, they had sold him to be a slave and torn his coat and dipped it in blood and sent it to the father, and they let their father think that he was dead for 20-some years, because he was 17 when they did that. He was 30 when he became king or vice pharaoh of Egypt or whatever he became. That's 17 years. Then there was 7 good years. So that's, and then the first or the second bad year. So at least 8 or 9 years later, so this is 26 years or so, that they let their dad believe this lie. How could you do that to your dad for 25, 26 years? What is wrong with these boys? Anyway, okay, next question. Thank you, Connor.
All right, no, thank you. The next question, also from Connor, says, Luke 1:17, what does it mean when the angel told Zacharias concerning John, that he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children? What does it mean to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children?
Hmm. Your phone is breaking up again, whatever it did the other day, battery dead or something.
Oh, no.
You still there, Rudy?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Can you hear me okay?
Or maybe it's just... I can hear you now. Maybe it's just the distance causes the microphone to...
Okay, sorry about that. I'll try to speak closer.
The molecules are... whatever type mic you have. Anyway, yes, Luke 1:17, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers. Certainly, John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elias, and Elias's job, whether that's Elijah or Elisha, either one, I think would be still truth, it'd still be the same. They back in end of 1 Kings and the beginning of 2 Kings, both of those prophets certainly tried to turn people to the Lord. That's what I've tried to do for 46 years. I say I want to get people saved, and if they're saved, I want to strengthen their faith in the Word of God. That's my goal. So this boy, John the Baptist, the angel is telling his dad, "This your son is going to turn people to the Lord like Elias did. Turn the hearts of the fathers." I don't think it was necessarily the spirit or the ghost of Elijah or anything like that, but it was the same spirit of
this call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
To turn people to the Lord and to make people ready to receive Jesus Christ, who came right after him, of course, his cousin, 6 months younger. That was Jesus Christ. Anyway, Connor, thank you for the question.
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. Connor has some more questions about Adam and Eve, and he says, if Adam and Eve were meant to live forever before the fall, what would have happened if they had fallen off a cliff or from a great height? And then he has some more questions as well.
Those what-if questions. Don't know. That's a good one. You know, what if? They go forever. You can never get out of that rabbit hole. They didn't. I mean, no, I don't know. So, can't answer that one. Maybe there were no cliffs.
That's right. Maybe there were none.
They're back then. Maybe. But still, there's obviously lots of ways you can get hurt. You know, even in a perfect world, you know. So, sorry, can't answer that one. What's the next one?
Okay, the next questions are also about Adam and Eve. I have a three-part question. Do you think Adam and Eve are in heaven or in hell? That's his first question.
Okay, well, let me one at a time. I don't know the answer to that. I suspect they're in heaven. But I don't know. It doesn't say. That's a very, you would think, after walking and talking with God for some length of time, maybe even 100 years before they sinned, we don't know the date, they certainly, after they sinned, would have, and God made them coats of skins, not bikinis out of fig leaves, that I think they knew what God wanted, and my suspicion would be that they did indeed receive God's righteousness and are in heaven. We'll have to see, though. Good question.
All right. The next question is, if they are in heaven and you get a chance to meet them, what would be the one question you would have for them, and what do you think they looked like?
Well, the first question I'm going to have for both of them is, can I see if you have a belly
button? Right.
They would be the only people on the planet to not have one. I don't know. I suspect they did not, and that would be a pretty cool witnessing tool to tell your great-great-great-great-grandkids, "Hey, boy, look at this. Wow, Grandpa, you don't have a belly button." No, that's right. I was created out of the dirt. I don't know. It's just my mind works that way. So I'm going to ask them if they got a belly button, and if they're not allowed to show me, then they can just tell me about it.
That's right. Very good. All right, Pastor Hovind, the next question I think comes from an anonymous person, and the anonymous person writes, Psalms 22:21b says, "For thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns." What does this mean?
Well, I wish I knew. There are, I think, I don't have my concordance here, but I think 7 references to unicorn in the Bible. If you read them all, it appears to be some kind of animal that is not tameable. Nobody trains them to pull your plow, to plow your field, or to carry the grain back to the barn. So my wild guess is that the unicorn.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Some type of reptile or even dinosaur, like probably, and apparently with one horn, because I cover that in my video number 7, Q&A time, what is the unicorn? I don't know, but I suspect a one-horned dinosaur like a Styracosaurus or Monoclonius, or there are several of them that only have one horn, and maybe God designed them with a big frill on their back of their head to plow up potatoes or carrots or something. Certainly would have been a good natural plow. We have a lot of animals that root in the ground, like pigs and stuff, you know, and they may have been something used to root with. Don't know. Have to wait and see when we get to heaven. Thank you for the question, though.
Very good.
Thanks for the call back, brother.
Yes, we have enough probably for one more call.
Okay, sounds great. It's a good time.
Okay, very good. All right, Pastor Ken Hovind, I need your Bible questions. I'm running out. RUDDAVIS@yahoo.com. You guys always come through, and I appreciate it. But don't hesitate to send me. April the 19th, we have Pastor Ken Hovind on the line, continuing with Bible questions. This is such a blessing, Pastor Hovind. I know you said it's a blessing for you, but I guarantee you it's a blessing for many, many people out here. There's just hundreds of people that are listening to these things, and we get Bible questions coming in all hours of the day and night. This one comes in from Ryan, sir, and Ryan writes, my question is about speaking in tongues. More so on the day of Pentecost, the apostles spoke in tongues when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and others could understand it in their own language. From what I've seen the last few years in Pentecostal churches, when they speak in tongues, it doesn't sound like another language. So the question is there two types of speaking in tongues? One type, like the day of Pentecostal, and another type where it can be where it can't be understood. Hope that the last question doesn't sound too naive. You're constantly in my prayers. Your friend, Brother Ryan.
Well, thank you, sir. The only kind of tongues mentioned in the Bible, the only kind, is the kind where it's a miraculous ability to speak an earthly language. That's clearly what is taught in Acts chapter 2. They were able to speak a language they had never studied. It was a miracle, no question, and it was a gift from God, and it was from the Holy Spirit, but it was not a heavenly gibberish or an unintelligible language. Then later in Acts chapter 10, Peter goes and they preach to Cornelius, and Cornelius, the Italian, gets saved, and he begins to speak with tongues. Acts chapter 10, verse 44. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them which heard the word. And verse 46, and they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Well, apparently they knew what they were saying. If they knew they were magnifying God, if you don't know what they're saying, how would you know they're not cursing God? And then Peter said, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost? And then when Peter goes back and explains this to the church at Jerusalem in Acts chapter 11, verse number 15, he said, and as I began, he's explaining this to the church, as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. And then verse 17, for as much then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us who believed. So we know clearly from Acts 11 that whatever happened to Cornelius was exactly what happened to Peter and the disciples in Acts 2, which means Cornelius was given the ability to speak a language he had never studied. Either Cornelius could suddenly speak Greek or Hebrew, since he's an Italian, a soldier stationed in a foreign country. All of a sudden, he can speak the local language, which makes sense. There are no, zero, nada, zip, none, no evidences any place in the scripture of anybody speaking a language that nobody around them could understand. In the book of 1 Corinthians, the passages are real clear that people were standing up speaking in the church in various languages, probably to demonstrate, wow, I've been traveling around, I'm a businessman, and I speak Russian or Swahili or something. And so it was a braggadocious thing. And finally, Paul wrote to them in 1 Corinthians and said, look, we're going to put some rules down. If you're going to speak in tongues in the church, only two or three, only if there's an interpreter, and no women. Read the passage. It's pretty clear. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Let your women keep silence in the churches. This is verse 34. Now, I think this is only to the Corinthians because they were getting carried away with this stuff. But he said in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 27, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course. In other words, go in order, and let one interpret. If there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. So I think what I see from Scripture is, if let's say my son's wife, Tanya, her family's from Ukraine. Her mom and dad are much better in Russian than they are in English. So when he comes over for Thanksgiving dinner, we say, Nick, would you pray? And he prays in Russian. Ah, Slava Boho, you know, and he goes on and on and on. Okay. In fact, he's comfortable. He's speaking to himself and to God. I don't know if I understand anything he's saying, but he does, and God does. It's not a heavenly tongue. It's Russian. It's an earthly language. So I cannot find any place in Scripture where there's a second type. So Ryan, my simple answer to the question is there's only one type of tongues in Scripture. It is a miraculous ability to speak a language you have never studied, and that was a miracle. I happen to believe those signs ceased at the time of the finishing of the New Testament, but if the gifts are still for today, it still is only the miraculous ability to speak an earthly language, not some heavenly language. Okay?
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Ken Hovind. The next question comes in from Steve, and Steve writes, he's got a fairly lengthy message on the key of David, but I think we can get through it. Steve writes, thank you, Pastor Ken Hovind. I pray for you often in your quest to be set free from prison on false charges by Satanists in high places. Recently, a question was asked about the key of David, and it appears that Steve has some very developed thoughts about the key of David, and here's what he's got to say. Revelation 3:7 was not giving a promise to any person to receive the key of David. The angel was addressing Jesus Christ by such a statement. Revelation 3:7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he, Jesus, that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth, and no man shutteth, and no man openeth. Jesus Christ is the only one which has the key of David, which is the way to God's kingdom. Believers do not get that key. Jesus alone holds that key and opens the way in for his faithful ones, but shuts it to those
from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
But shuts it to those who fail to listen and believe in him. Isaiah 22:22. And the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder, so he shall open and none shall shut, and he shall shut and none shall open. May I suggest an idea? Make an arrangement so that all followers of Christ Jesus gather and offer incense, prayers, jointly at a precise time just before Kent Hovind goes into court that day to plead to God for justice for Kent in court that day. Yours truly, Steve. Any comments about that? And praise God for Steve.
Well, thank you. That's brilliant research. And yes, I agree. You're right. Only Jesus has the key. So the idea where it says in the Bible, the noise of his triumph was heard throughout the land, the key of David is apparently not the key to a Triumph motorcycle or car. So you cleared that up for me. I was just kidding, of course. Anyway, thank you so much, Steve. As far as all praying at one time, that would be wonderful. Rudy, you'd have to work that kind of stuff out. I can't from here. But I would rather everybody pray that they drop this charge and it not even go to trial. There's no reason Paul and I can't go home today, except that they won't drop these stupid charges and drop this trial. This doesn't even need to go to trial. This is dumb.
Amen.
You get a lot of pressure from their boss. Did anybody do anything with the FOIA to find out the total cost of this persecution?
Yeah, I have sent in a FOIA request. I sent it to a generic department, and they've forwarded it to a specific department, and I'm going to be following up on that Monday. And I think Pastor Wally Drake sent in a FOIA request as well, so we've got multiple people that have sent in FOIA requests. I'm going to be following up on my request on Monday, and I'll let you know more as it develops.
I think somebody should also do a FOIA to the IRS and say, how much have you spent? Because Scott Schneider's been on my case for 15 years.
Ah, good point. I will absolutely do that.
IRS spent. I mean, the Justice Department. Yeah, Justice Department's only going to give you a part of the picture.
Right. Good point.
How much has the prison system spent? How much did the prison system spend on imprisoning me?
That's another good point.
In 2 months.
Right.
They've transported me all over the country. They've housed me at all kinds of different locations. They keep getting different clothes, food. What has it? So what the Justice Department spent on the persecution is only a small part of it. We also need the IRS cost and the prison cost.
Very good point.
And if you really want to get the part that's a lot of money, see what it cost me and my family in the ministry.
Yes.
That's the big part.
Yes.
Anyway, you don't need to FOIA that. I wouldn't have a clue, but I know it's been a lot.
I know it has.
But my grandkids' childhood.
Mm.
I've never rocked my grandson to sleep.
Mm.
I missed that 8 years and 2 months. Terrible. It's evil. Yeah. It's cruel.
Yes,
awful.
I know. We're looking forward to the day you walk out of there, Pastor Hovind, and the sooner the better, and we're looking forward to that day, and we're going to appeal to the Creator of the universe. I've told people many times that it's our responsibility to get you out of there. It's not your responsibility to get out. You didn't do anything wrong. So we're praying and we're appealing to the Creator of the universe, and many, many people are starting to wake up to what's going on.
And
I would say just in the last few months, the injustices of the IRS is getting mainstream attention. Lois Lerner and how they're targeting conservative individuals. And that seems to be like one of the topics of mainstream news all over the country, is how the IRS is, I think one congressman referred to them as the most corrupt IRS in the history. And so hopefully, you know, I don't know what we can do. It's just a terrible situation, but at the same time, God is getting the glory, and we will continue to make noise and shine light, just like Gideon's army.
Well, it's real simple. Congress and the Senate make the laws. Okay? Pass a law that abolishes them.
Amen.
Simply abolish the IRS completely. Not necessary. None of the money they collect goes to buy one bullet or one battleship. It all goes to pay interest on the national debt.
Amen.
Check that out sometime.
Amen, amen.
If you owe a tax, you definitely ought to pay it. I'm not a tax protester, but I see why some people are. Anyway, that's not me, though. I got a different dragon to slay.
Amen, amen.
Next question.
All right, there is a lot of dragons. Okay, Pastor Hovind, the next question comes in from Zelchka from Croatia. And Zelchka writes, I sent you a question, but I think you maybe missed it somehow. So it goes like this. Hi, thank you, Mr. Hovind, for answering my previous question about life after death. Now my question is, what are souls doing when people die? What are they? Where are they? Are they watching over us? It's clear we don't have contact with them, because when somebody is talking to the dead, that's demons faking the voice of the dead. Can you recommend some Christian books on this topic? Thank you for your answers. Zelchka from Croatia.
I don't know that I can recommend any. Thank you for the question, by the way. I'd love to come visit Croatia sometime, and Latvia and Estonia and that whole, and Yugoslavia and Herzegovina and that whole area. I got close. I got to Italy and I got to Romania, but I never got to Croatia or any of that. But I'll come one of these days. Anyway, love to come. Save a few heathen for me so I can get them converted. As far as what happens to the souls after they die, the Bible's pretty clear. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So the Christians go straight to heaven. I think the story, not the parable, but the actual true story in the book of Luke about the rich man and Lazarus is pretty clear, that the rich man died, and in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. But he still got eyes, he can still hear, he can still talk, he can still feel. I don't know what kind of body they get. Obviously, his original earthly body is rotting in a grave someplace, but this guy, this rich man, it can hear, talk, see, feel. They must get some kind of body. I can't figure it out. I don't know that the Bible gives enough details to be dogmatic, but I'm sure there are plenty of books on the topic, but I can't think of one right now. Anyway, sorry about that. But thank you for the question.
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question comes in from Rob, and Rob writes, if a Christian doesn't provide for his own, is he worse than an infidel and thus no longer saved?
Well, the Bible does say, if any man provide not for his own, he's worse than an infidel. He denied the faith and worse than an infidel. I don't think it says he's no longer saved. An infidel, certainly, is a person who's lack of fidelity, lack of...
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Fidelity, but an infidel typically in the Bible is a person who's wicked or lives in sin, and a person who doesn't provide for his own family is worse than an infidel. But that would not necessarily relate to going to hell, because salvation is not related to your good works, but to Jesus' finished work on the cross. All right.
No, thank you, Pastor Hovind. I think
Are there more, brother?
Well, let me collect some more for tonight, if that's okay, and I'll get them arranged in a way that I can read them and get the font at the proper size. And if that sounds like a good plan to you, we'll pick it up tonight, if that sounds good. And if
I will call in my next dear God.
Yes, anytime.
You got an email coming up too.
Yeah, if you get done with that, call us at any time. We'll be glad to record that and get that out as well.
Sounds great. Thank you, brother. You're a blessing.
Okay, thank you, Pastor Hovind. God bless. All right, that was Pastor Hovind. I'm kind of running out of questions here, so I need your guys' help. I think it's good for him as he's stuck in that jail cell. Of course, he's doing everything he can to win souls to the Lord in that jail cell, but getting on this phone and answering Bible questions, I think, is not only good therapy for him, it's a blessing for us. You guys have been a wonderful blessing. I know that I'm always asking for more Bible questions, but that's because he eats them like candy. And I just need you guys to send him more Bible questions, right? We got 29 more days, and we want him to be out of there as soon as possible. And I think it's just good, right? It's a learning experience for all of us. And if it helps him pass the time, then it's a win-win situation for everybody. And I'm certainly learning a lot. So RUDDAVIS@yahoo.com, and call me with your testimony, 972-839-9848. And all of this is a blessing from God, and we'll give God the glory through every step.
All right,
it's
Bible Questions with Ken Hovind, April the 19th. They're rolling in, Pastor Hovind. We praise God for all these people for sending in these questions. This one comes from Teresa, and Teresa says, Dear Pastor Hovind, this morning I got to hear your whole debate with skeptic evolutionist Michael Shermer. That was a lively debate. Towards the end of the question and answer period, he was sitting crooked with his back facing you. I haven't seen that one. I'll have to go check that one out. Very defeated body language. LOL. My question was, in the first 20 minutes intro, he proclaimed in 1971 he became a born-again Christian and then left it. When he woke up, I guess, was he a tare, a false or deceived person, or is he a backslidden Christian? Blessings in Christ, Teresa.
Well, I sure don't know, Teresa. I hope he's saved. I don't know. He's sure done a lot of damage to the cause of Christ since then, with his Skeptics magazine and Skeptics publications. I'm not God. I can't be his judge, but I find it hard to believe that he's a Christian, a born-again Christian, and can leave like that. I think he was maybe a tare, but we'll see Judgment Day. I agree with the defeated body language. Not only that, he was defeated intellectually and psychologically and scientifically in every possible way. Well, he's defending the wrong view. It's like trying to defend the flat earth. I'm sorry, it's just wrong. He's trying to defend the evolution view. I'm sorry, it's not that I'm smarter, it's that I'm right. I'm defending the right side. So, yeah, I've debated him several times, actually. He's been involved in 3 debates with me. I don't know if he'll do it again. I sure would. Sure, any day, any time. I'll write to him and tell him. Kent said, any time. You name the time and spot, I'll be there if I can. All right, thank you, Teresa.
All right, very good. Pastor Hovind, the next question comes in from Kevin, and Kevin writes, hey, Pastor Hovind, thank you very much for answering my question. I have another question. I have a friend who's very knowledgeable of the scriptures, but he keeps sinning willfully, and I asked him if it's possible to keep sinning and still be saved. This upset him, and I think he said, do you expect everybody to be perfect? And sent me like a barrage of verses from the Bible having to do with temptation. I stopped hanging around him and my other friends because they do nothing but drugs and sell it. But the friend I am talking about does not. He is just around it and supports it. Should I try to get them to turn away from that? Or should I just keep away from them like 2 Timothy 3, 1-5 says to do? Some of them do not believe in God and get angry when I bring up the topic. And sometimes I feel like they want to fight me. So I just separated from them for now. Thank you again, Pastor Hovind, for sharing your thoughts. Kevin.
Well, thank you, Kevin. There's a whole lot of proverbs about this very thing. You know, some people you just cannot be around. Even Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. Don't stand with them, don't sit with them, don't talk with them, don't walk with them. I mean, so can a person sin willfully over and over after they're saved? They can, but it's dangerous. 1 John chapter 5, they're asking for God to say, okay, come on home to heaven, son. You're a disgrace to the family. So I can't answer if they're saved or not. Only God knows that. But I know Romans chapter 1 talks about some people who not only do things wrong, but the last couple of verses talks about have pleasure in them that do them. I think it's just as wrong and wicked for a person to sit and laugh at someone else who sins. So when you see someone else get drunk or get on drugs or do something wicked or sinful, that's where so many TV programs come in. I think Christians are going to answer to God based on the last 2 verses of Romans 1, because they didn't do those things, but they had pleasure in them that do them. To me, that would involve an awful lot of movies and shows on TV, and Christians better read that, go look in the mirror and say, God, is this me? Am I breaking that one? So, yes, Kevin, you are much better off with absolutely no friends than bad friends. I've got several, maybe a dozen or more, teenagers or younger, who write to me regularly, who say, look, I don't have any friends. I say, well, I'll be your friend. I'll be your grandpa. Your adopted grandpa. And I write to them regularly. They write to me and they pour their heart out. And I say, look, I'll help any way I can. But you're better off with absolutely no friends than friends that are going to get you in trouble. So count me in, Kevin. If you need me for another grandpa, you just holler. I'll be there. Okay.
All right. No, thank you, Pastor Owen. I'm going to have to remember that. That's going to come in handy, I guarantee you. You're better off with no friends. You're better off with no friends than bad friends. I'll have to remember that one for some time to come. All right, Pastor Hovind, the next question also comes... Yes, sir. All right, yes, sir. Okay, all right. Yes, sir, the next question comes in from Therese. And Therese writes, in Psalms 115:16, there is a beautiful verse... The heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's, but the earth hath he given to the children of men. How do we convince atheists that there is no creation on other planets or galaxies? Because they belong to God. The Hubble telescope is confirming this. Blessings, Therese.
I don't know that you can convince atheists of anything. You can try. I would say, look, as far as that, we all know scientifically there is simply no evidence of any life, any place outside of this solar system. If you want to believe there is, that's perfectly fine. If you want to search for life on other planets, that's perfectly fine, as long as you're paying for the search. SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. People have asked me many times, Brother Hovind, do you think there's intelligent life on other planets? And I say, I taught high school 15 years. I've debated 100 atheists. There's not much intelligent life on this planet. No, I do not believe there's any intelligent life on any other planets. There are certainly angels and demons according to the Bible, but I've never seen either one of those. Couldn't prove either of those scientifically. So purely scientifically, which is what we can observe, study, test, demonstrate, there is no, zero, zip, nil, nada, no evidence of any intelligent life on any other planet. Okay? Thank you for the question.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Hovind. The next question comes in from Mark in Belfast. And Mark writes, hello, Brother Hovind. Your advice is amazing. It's a bit like having Jesus on speed dial here. I'm not saying you're actually Jesus, Brother Hovind, LOL. Therefore, the wisdom you receive from Scripture and then delivering it to us, you are a brilliant man for it and a tribute to Jesus Christ. And here's his question. Did Jesus ever get married? And if he didn't, do you think the women would have found him attractive and asking Jesus like, hey, would you like to dance? Maybe you take a romantic walk or... Would you like to pick some flowers? These thoughts go through my mind. Jesus must have had to say no to the advancements of the women a lot. What do you think? That's from Brother Mark in Belfast, Ireland. A little bit off the beaten track, but any response to that?
Interesting question. I don't know about the Jesus on speed dial. I've been accused of a lot of things. Never been accused of that one, so that's a new one. Thank you. I'm definitely not Jesus, I can assure you. I do read his book a lot, and I want to try to think the way he thinks and let the mind of Christ be in me, so if I can give what I think he would say to a question, that's the goal, obviously. And then thank you for the compliment. Jesus being married, the answer is absolutely not. He certainly was not. There's not a single scripture to indicate that. Was he attractive? I don't know. He looked like all the rest of the Jews of his time. Judas had to go kiss him to pick him out of the crowd. So, I don't know. Were they attracted to him? That I don't know either. Certainly, quite a few men, women, and children hung around him all the time. People wanted to be with him, that's for sure. It's always a really good sign when children want to be with the person. That's a good indication that they're friendly, happy, joking. If kids don't want to be around you, something is seriously wrong with your personality or something. So just watch anybody in a crowd. Do the kids want to be with them? That's, to me, the goal, and I try to specifically seek out and try to encourage and try to... uplift and build up any kids that come around. Make them feel important instead of make them feel stupid. It's easy to make yourself look smart in front of kids. That's not the goal. The goal is to make them feel important and needed and wanted. When families write to me and they sign mom, dad, and they name the kids, I usually pick the youngest of the kids to write back to in a response, thank you for the letter. Just to make them feel, whoa, I got a letter. Just getting a letter, period.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
is wonderful. So to answer the question, I would say there's zero evidence that Jesus was married, and no. Now, he will be. The church is called the Bride of Christ, which is a strange phenomenon that I do not claim to understand. But that's what it says. We are the Bride of Christ. Mentioned in Revelation, the bride has made herself ready. I think it's chapter 19 or so. So that's coming. I don't understand what all that means, but they've covered the marriage feast of the Lamb. So Jesus will be married one day, whatever that means, in eternity. Thank you for the question. Hope that helps, Mark, and I'll get over there to Ireland one of these days and preach. Good. Any other questions, Rudy? I can call back. It's a good time now.
All right. Yeah, I think we do have a few more, Pastor Hovind.
Okay, I'll call right back.
Okay, God bless. All right, we got a few more questions, and we'll work through these as well. Looking forward to it. R-U-D-D-A-V-I-S at Yahoo.
Ken Hovind.
An inmate at the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office. This call will be recorded and monitored. Your advance pay account balance is $9.74. For customer assistance, billing inquiries, or to block future calls, dial 1-877-650-4249. To hear the cost of this call, press 8 now. To accept this call, press 5 now. To decline this call, hang up. This call is subject to monitoring and recording. Do not use three-way or call waiting features during this call. Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
I have a quick question about kids. You know, you were just talking about kids and how they love to be, or I know they love to be around me, and when they meet me, they just want to stick to me like glue. But I when I look at a child now, I just feel like crying because I see their future in this tyrannical country, and it makes me very sad. And I just wondered if you had any words of wisdom for me, because even just thinking about it makes me want to cry.
Me too. I look and say, wow, it makes me want to cry. Jesus, he knew in 70 AD the Roman Empire was going to come in and wipe out the whole nation of Israel. And killed a million of them just in Jerusalem. What do you say? You know, God knew that Herod was going to go kill all the babies in Bethlehem. Gee whiz, imagine poor God. He knows everything. Yeah, it's tough. That's why I try purposely to build them up and make them. You got to realize, all through history, people have been persecuted and killed, and the prophets and, you know, persecution has been common. So, but God promises great rewards if we suffer for Him. So, if you get the kids to be strong enough to say, well, even if bad things happen, I'm going to serve God. All through history, there have been many kids who suffered. Look at Hitler in Germany, and Russia, and China, and Vietnam, and it's just. I'm ready for God to wipe away all tears and put an end to this insanity. This is crazy. But I'm glad kids like to be with you. That's a good sign.
Yeah, I guess this feeling is nothing new.
Yeah, I operate and live and think about fourth grade level, which is probably what it's like me, because I'm right on their same level. Amen.
All right. Okay,
thank you.
Yep, thank you. Thank you for responding. Pastor Hovind, the next series of paragraphs come from someone who doesn't necessarily subscribe to the King James only position. His name is, I'll just refer to him as Prepper. And if you like, I'll read one of the four, and I'll just read one paragraph at a time, and maybe let you respond.
Sure.
Okay. Hello, Dr. Kent. Before I say anything, I want to let you know that I am a sincere brother in Christ who has studied the issues I am about to present to you. Please do not attack me, but attack my arguments. I have to say I strongly disagree with your opinions of James White and the King James only controversy. Here are a few excerpts from a detailed response to your statements that I would like you to respond to. I will be mailing you the rest. Okay, that's paragraph 1 of 4. Here's paragraph 2 of 4. God is obligated to preserve His Word. He has preserved His Word, but we need to clear up a few myths about inerrancy. Inspiration is not dictation. God did not guide every single pen movement or every single word. Inspiration is God using His natural methods of His human creations to get the results He wants. Inerrant does not mean the inerrant copies as proved by textual variants and scribal errors. preservation does not need to be taken to the extremes. That's the second of four paragraphs. Shall I continue, or did you want to respond to paragraph two?
No, I definitely want to respond, maybe even line by line.
Okay,
well, let me ask you a question. Pepper, thank you for the comment. And I would, believe me, I'd look at the argument, not the person. I don't care. I can be friendly, disagree without being disagreeable. You say God did preserve his word. Wonderful. I'm glad you believe that. Would you please hand me a copy of it? Can you or James White give me a copy of this word that God preserved? I want letter for letter, word for word. I don't want to have to wonder which one's translated or copied correctly. I don't want to have a guru to have, I have to go to them for answers. I would like to hold a copy of this preserved word. I agree that God is obligated to preserve his word. So my question to you or James White or anybody else, where is it? Will you send me one, please? I would love to get that.
Alright,
next paragraph.
Okay, next paragraph. Has God preserved his word or not? That's the question KJV only folks always come back to. Unfortunately, they always seem to assume that unless you have a perfect English translation, you don't have a perfect Bible. Of course, English did not come into existence until more than 1,000 years after the last words of Scripture were written. Hence, making a perfect English translation the standard is obviously an error. That's the third paragraph.
Oh, okay. Well, then, do you have a perfect Greek or Hebrew one or French one or Italian one or Polish one or Cherokee one? Where is God's preserved perfect word?
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
The argument from the King James folks like me, I think, is a very legitimate one. They certainly he did not preserve it in the Hebrew and Greek. Those are long gone. He had it written in the language of the day. The world trade language in Jesus' day was Greek. The Greeks had conquered the world a few centuries earlier, the known world over there, the Mediterranean. Today, the world trade language is English. Pilots have to learn English to fly and land at airports. So, where is it? I think I think he did it in the English. But if you think it's in some other language, I can understand that argument. Believe me, I know English wasn't around till you should try to read Beowulf written 500 AD. I can't read a word on the page. And it's English. Everything has changed. I understand. So my question still is, where is it? If you don't think it's in English, I would like a copy of it. If it's in Greek, I'd like to know who has this. What library can I go to? Where is the Word of God? Just real simple. Who has a copy of it? I want to see it. I want to hold it. I want to touch it. People say, well, it's in the originals. I won't buy that. The originals are gone. Nobody has them. So, tell me. Again, my argument stands. Question next. Question still stands. Where is it? If not English, then where? I believe, and it took me 25 years to get to that point, God did preserve it in the English. For the world. I'm holding a copy. But thank you. Okay, next paragraph number four.
Amen. All right, here's the fourth paragraph from Prepper. How then has God preserved his word? He has done so by making sure that the New Testament was so quickly distributed all over the known world that there was never a time when any man / group / church could gather up all copies and make wholesale changes. By the 3rd century, entire manuscripts were already buried. If major changes were made after that time, they would be easily detectable by comparison with those earlier manuscripts.
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
Please show me one. I think the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found that were buried about the 1st century documented clearly that the King James is indeed the preserved Word of God. They clearly show that all these other translations are not the preserved Word of God. I think the buried versions from the 1st century show clearly that the King James translators were indeed God's Word is preserved in that particular translation. For the world, certainly for the English-speaking people, So if I were going to make a, if I was a missionary to some new island someplace and had to translate a Bible into their language, I would translate it from the English King James. I would not translate it from the Greek or Hebrew. Now that will get a lot of negative emails and phone calls, Rudy, but that's, I believe it that strongly. I would translate it from the English.
Amen.
If someone says, rather than correcting the English with the Greek, I think you should correct the Greek from the English. Because Greek, yeah, there's several different flavors of it.
Right.
Someone says, it says in the Greek, okay, which Greek? We can actually correct these corrupt Greek manuscripts from the preserved English version.
Amen.
That's my belief, and I'm sticking to it. Unless somebody can give me some clear evidence, I should not. I'm willing to talk about it and debate it and discuss it. I'm very open to that. I'm cool, calm, and collected, and secure in my position. Okay.
Amen, amen. Now, thank you for that, Pastor Hovind. And I got to pull out one statement by Prepper that kind of struck me that maybe maybe could use, you know, I would like to talk about it a little bit more, but Prepper wrote in the second paragraph, inerrant does not mean inerrant copies, as proved by textual variants and scribal errors. Preservation does not need to be taken to the extremes. It seems like Prepper has consigned himself to the position that any Bible he's going to hold is going to have errors in it, right? Because he says inerrant does not mean inerrant copies. So if he believes that God's Word has errors in it, doesn't that open the door that now we need a guru? Now we've got to have a professor to tell us what God means, because who's going to, if the difference between, you know, Mr. Prepper, he may say there's only three or four errors in the whole Bible, but the professor down the street says there's 30 errors in the Bible, and of course the atheist believes the whole Bible is full of errors. So it's like, what's the distinction between a guy that says there's three errors and a guy that says there's 300,000 errors? I mean, what about the guy who says there's absolutely zero errors and that God preserved his word perfectly, just like he promised us he would do? It just seems like a very slippery slope to be able to consign yourself to the position that God's word can have errors in it. And it's I just think that's a very dangerous position to give the opposition camp, you know, that says the Bible is nothing but fairy tales.
Well, I agree. I have a facsimile copy of the original 1611 King James. I read through the whole thing, and there are quite a few printing errors. For instance, I think it's in the book of Daniel, where at the top of the page it says Daniel, and then all of a sudden it says Hosea, and then it says Daniel. The printers made a mistake. They labeled it. The text continues on as it should, but they labeled the top of the page that it's coming from Hosea, or something like that. Anyway, there are thousands of printing errors and spelling errors in the 1611 King James. Those were corrected in the 1768 or whatever it was when they redid it. I have the Defender's Study Bible by Henry Morris. It is wonderful. I highly recommend it. But as I went through it for years, I made notes in the front page of typing errors, copyist errors. They left out a whole line in one of the verses. When we got the message that there was somebody had bought the rights and was going to reprint the Henry Morris Defender Study Bible, which they did. It's much larger. It's on cheaper paper, I guess, but the thing is huge. But I sent in all my typos, and they corrected all of them. So there were certainly typographical errors and printing errors in that particular printed edition of the King James Version. So I would agree with him that inspiration does not mean preservation of everybody's printed copy. It's certainly possible for a printer to make, whoever does the typesetting or types it in, certainly can make an error. That's easily fixed. There are lots of King James Bibles around the world, like billions of them. It's easy to compare and check that. So he may have a valid point. I think the bigger picture, though, is the King James translation, that God preserved his word through those guys. It's my position. I think that's correct. And then the printer can make mistakes. I could quote a verse right this minute and deliberately make a mistake. That doesn't change the verse. It would just change my version of it. Okay?
All right. No,
thank you for that. I appreciate that. I would tell James White to keep studying, keep climbing the mountain of truth, and I'll be waiting at the top on this one for him.
Amen, amen, amen. All right, Pastor Hovind, the next question. Yes, sir? Nope. This next question comes in from Minnesota, and Minnesota writes, what did Paul mean with the passage to Timothy at 1 Timothy 6:20-21? O Timothy,
Keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, falsely so called, or falsely called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Thank you for your question and answer times. I immensely enjoy them. From Minnesota.
Well, thank you. The word science simply means knowledge, and that can involve a whole variety of fields. We have the science of geology, the science of biology, botany, astronomy. I mean, there's a long, long list of many, probably many thousands of fields of knowledge, we'll call it, or fields of expertise. Someone can be an expert in the field of metallurgy or husbandry, growing.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Raising animals. There are many things taught that are falsely considered science. They're not science. Paul was warning Timothy to be careful about false science. I think evolution falls squarely into that category. It's not science. It's a religion. And it's flatly dumb, in my humble opinion. Anyway, I think that's what he's talking about there.
Amen, amen.
Thank you for the question. And should I call back? We got supper in a few minutes. I can call later tonight if that's better.
Maybe later tonight is better, and I'll work at gathering a few more. And we thank you for the time that you spent today. It's always interesting and always a blessing, Pastor Owen.
Thank you, brother. All right, talk to you later.
Bye-bye. Okay, God bless. Bye bye. All right, we don't take any of these calls for granted. We enjoy every single one of them, and every single time it's a blessing to talk about these Bible issues. And send me your Bible questions. You know, you guys know the drill, RUDDAVIS@yahoo.com. And you can also go to his website, freekenthoven.com, 2peter3.com. And I recommend everyone listen to, or not listen to, but read those websites and investigate what's going on in his case. We need to be making noise and shining light about the injustices that are going on with Ken Hovind, and we need him out of prison. And we're going to make as much noise and shine as much light as we possibly can. God bless everyone.
Ken Hovind here, calling from jail, hopefully not for much longer. People read to me all your comments and stuff about my comments. You started this. I mean, you're the one that wrote the Forbes magazine. I didn't start. I've never met you. And I'm just simply defending myself, sharing the other side. Now, I do want to say this, that you have absolutely nothing to fear from me. I don't threaten anybody. I've been married 42 years and have never threatened or hit my wife. I'm a peace-loving man, so you have nothing to fear, I assure you. Now, I also want to say that I greatly appreciate your zeal. There's no question you really honestly believe what you're doing, and you really honestly want to do something and create a dinosaur university or whatever it is you want to do. I appreciate your zeal. It is misguided. It's for the wrong purpose, but those people like you make great Christians when they get converted. The Apostle Paul used to be Saul, who persecuted Christians and hated Christians. And when he got converted, wow, did he get changed. And he wrote half the books of the New Testament. So that can happen to you. C.S. Lewis, the famous author, was an atheist, and he became a Christian and really totally turned his life around. So I'm going to pray, Amanda, that you really go look in the mirror and say, am I ready to face God? Do I really believe that I came from a rock 4.6 billion years ago? But what is going to happen when I die? You are going to die, and you're going to be dead for a really, really long time. You ought to pack a lunch for that trip. And I'm going to pray that you do accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. He loves you. He died on the cross to pay for your sins. He's willing to accept you into his family. You have nothing to fear from me, I assure you. Now, as far as you mentioned in the article about helping Anthony Jaworski, I think that is wonderful, and I think you should. The poor guy, he needs lots of help. I'll be glad to help him, too. So, if you want to buy that property and then let him move back to Maryland, go buy it. Once this is over with and I win, then the government will have to straighten it out. It'll come back to me or to the ministry, and then we can try to help you get your money back. It won't be a profit or we...
This call is from the Santa Rosa County Sheriff's Office.
We're very helpful, and all we want to do is use the law to have this great injustice overturned. So... Anyway, I just want to assure you, no threats from me, and I'll be praying for you specifically that you end up giving your heart and life and that great deal that you have over to the Lord so he can use it. Thank you, thank you. As far as Robert Batty goes, anti-government tax cheating sovereign citizens. Okay, Batty, I am none of those. I am
not anti-government. We need government. Absolutely. No question. Government is essential to keep guys like you in line so you do what's right. I'm not anti-government. You can't show me any place where I'm anti-government. I think maybe some people who pose as government agents are acting outside of their constitutional authority, so that they would technically be the anti-government. I am not a tax cheat. I pay every tax I owe. I would like you to show what tax, specifically, I have not paid. If I owe a tax, I pay it. I mean, sales tax, gas tax. You know, if you go buy a ring, you got to pay a jewelry tax. There's hundreds of taxes. I am not, and never have been, a tax cheat or anti-tax. I think if you owe it, you should pay it. And I'm certainly, I don't understand what you mean by sovereign citizen. If only God is sovereign. And I don't know what you mean by citizen. I thought I used to know what that word meant, but I don't think. I'm confused. It's words in common usage to the average person might mean something. But then in the government, when they pass a law, they say at the beginning of the law or statute, this, for the purpose of the statute, this word means ABC. So, what exactly do you mean by citizen? Please send me your definition of that and your definition of sovereign, and I'll tell you if I agree or not. But so far, I don't think I understand how the average person, how it's getting confused between the typical meaning of the word or the Webster's dictionary definition and the legal definition. So we need to define some terms a little more carefully. And just as a word of advice, it says in the book of Proverbs, if a fool holds his peace, he's counted as a wise man. Just by not talking, people think, wow, you must be smart. I think you could use some of that, Robert. Quit talking, quit writing for a while. Then maybe it'll improve your score. All right. Thank you so much. If I can help, count me in. That's all I
need. It's all you. We're going.
All right. This is to those who sent me the fresh favorites. Thank you so much. The only four of them had names on them, so I'm not sure who got all nine of them, but it was a royal blessing to the guy. One came from David. Last name starts with a T-H. I won't say the last name. Another one came from Thomas. Last name starts with a S-K. Another one came from Nick, and last name starts with a K-A-R. Another one came from Dorita. Last name starts with a H-A-R. Anyway, thank you so much. It was a royal blessing, a great blessing to the guys. They just were so excited. And thank you. Most of them have not had anything other than the prison food here, which is, how can we say it? Sadly lacking. Anyway, but it was a blessing. Anyway, if you want to put money on their account instead, that would prevent any arguments or fights here. I just happened to have eight guys in the Bible study working on Bible verses, so when I got nine fresh favorites, it worked out perfect. If I got more or less, it was, uh-oh, what do I do now, you know? I don't want to cause trouble, get myself beat up in here for for something. Not that that would happen, I don't think. No problems at all. Anyway, thank you so much. I appreciate it very much, and if you want to do that anytime, maybe we can work it out where I don't ever get more than nine. Somebody has to keep track of it, or better yet, just put the money on account. Even on my account, I can order them from there. If I had the money on my account, Ernie Land can explain how to do that, then I can order as many as I want, as I know how many guys need one. Anyway, that's all I had. Thank you.
That was very, very interesting that the head of Joseph Stalin's secret police said, show me the man and I'll show you the crime. They just make up crimes for whoever they want to, when they have a political opponent, they just make up the crime and put him in jail.
I'm familiar with that quote, and I've read extensively on Joseph Stalin. He went to a Christian school as a kid, and when he read Darwin's book, it changed him into an atheist.
Oh, my goodness.
This evolution theory is way more than just stupid. It's incredibly dangerous. That's what motivated Adolf Hitler. That's what converted Joseph Stalin. How else can a person justify doing those crazy things of murdering so many millions of people? Well, you have to get it in your mind that they're not human. They're just animals. They're just evolved. There is no absolute standard of right and wrong. It's a dangerous, dangerous religion, and I've devoted my life to exposing it.
Amen.
Anyway, so,
amen.
Yeah, but thank you for that, though. But I'm not familiar with that new guy. I'm familiar with IRS targeting conservative ministry. That's their purpose.
Yeah.
They're shut them down.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Well, when you get out of prison, which hopefully will be very, very soon, or county jail, or whatever they call where you're at, we look forward to just showing you all kinds of good movies that will bring you up to speed. But you've been a target of this long before it's getting popular now, and it's getting a lot of publicity. But I think you've experienced it long before it became popular. So, in any event, all right, Pastor Hovind, unless you have anything, we're still collecting Bible questions. We'll be ready for tomorrow morning, and I'll make sure that those administrative things get taken care of.
Sounds great. All right, thank you, brother. I'll call you tomorrow.
All right, God bless. Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, that was Pastor Hovind, and I just got through watching Dinesh D'Souza's movie America. While I may not agree with every single thing in it, I do agree that the IRS does target conservative individuals. Pastor Hovind is a particularly flagrant example of that. And the quote that really came out in that movie for me was, "Show me the man, and I'll show you the crime," by Lavrentia Beria, who was the head of Joseph Stalin's secret police. So that's all for tonight. God bless.